Well, welcome to our lecture this evening. It's bound to be another extremely wonderful one where we learn so much about the things that we take for granted. We have all heard so many things in the past that kind of blur things. And through these lectures, we're kind of clarifying and seeing what's there, what's the roots behind some of the things that we are constantly dealing with in our own society. And this is just one of those wonderful things. Our lecture tonight is brought to us through the Birch Foundation. They are a couple from West Michigan, both grew up here, one in Holland and one in Muskegon, who met during World War II. They have dedicated their lives to service to their country. She was in the Waves and he was in the Navy during World War II. Fred Birch Sr. actually was at Pearl Harbor on that fatal day, and he managed to get a letter home that was not wasn't completely censored. And at one point during the letter home, he writes to his parents and he said, "Those planes are flying so low, I wish more of my friends had done duck hunting growing up, because we could have taken out so many more of them." And he went on to have a long career in the Navy. His wife, after several years, after the end of the war, stayed home from the Navy and raised their family. He became a teacher and eventually a principal. But they felt that setting up this foundation through their children was the way to promote service to the local, state, federal community, and do it through education. Because the more that people know about the community that they live in and the society that they are from, the more likely they are to contribute to it in a meaningful way. And so I would like to thank the Birch Foundation for sponsoring this lecture. Additionally, we have the Blue Lakes Public Radio is our media sponsor for this. And any of you that listen to them, you know that they always are just our wonderful, wonderful sponsors and give us all these great, great promotional discussions on each week on their series. Tonight, we have our wonderful presenter, Fred Johnson, is ready to give us another enthralling lecture. And I will ask that everyone mute yourself during the presentation. And then if you have a question, please put it into the chat box and then I will unmute you so that we don't have any interruptions or background noises. And then at the very end, everyone can unmute themselves and we can all have a discussion about the topic that we've discussed this evening. If Fred is all set to go, I am ready to turn over the mic to him. So let's hear it for another wonderful presentation. Fred, take it away.
Thank you, Peg, very much. And good evening to you all, scholars of the Silverside Museum. It is such a pleasure to be with you one more time, the privilege of sharing this information with you. I would like to go ahead and co-sign what Peg just said, that the more we know about our society, the more we know about how we got to where we are, it, first of all, clears away so many misconceptions and misinformation about who we are and where we came from, but it underscores the contributions of those who have contributed, those whose shoulders we stand upon, and I agree with her. It should compel us to get involved, and most of all, to not take this democratic republic for granted. It is still a constitutional democratic republic, which is a precious thing and needs to be preserved. Tonight, we look into the rise of the Cold War, particularly the rise of communism and the eventual clash between East and West, more specifically the United States and the Soviet Union, that happened almost instantaneously as World War II was either ending or ended. So let's start right here. Starting with this flag on these two flags on the right that you see, the flag with the hammer and the sickle, that would be the flag of the Soviet Union, and of course the deer, stars and stripes, the flag of the United States. The thing that set the Cold War apart from just every other conflict in human history, and if you take a look at World War I and World War II, and frankly the 30 Years' War and other conflicts, World War I and World War II, they did a real good job of showing the sheer raw capacity of human beings for waging war and raining destruction and misery onto each other. But the thing that set the Cold War apart was that now, for the first time in human history, human beings literally had within their capacity, literally had within their control, the ability to destroy the planet and themselves. It was the most dangerous 45, 50 years of human existence for one specific reason. The weapons called nuclear weapons or atomic bombs, and then eventually hydrogen bombs.
That's probably because they knew this would create a large cloud. And that would really spark people's interest around on, you know, what's that big cloud? Had you been outside here in Albuquerque, you would have seen the sky light up and wonder what was that?
J. Robin Oppenheimer, one of the lead scientists on the Manhattan Project, which was that project, the secret project, to develop the atomic weapon that eventually were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki on August 9th, August 6th and 9th, 1945. On the day that they tested the first bomb at Alamogordo, New Mexico, as soon as he saw the flash, Robert Oppenheimer basically became an anti-nuclear activist. He had no idea that the bomb would have that kind of destructive power. Of course, they wanted it to work. They wanted it to be spectacular. But when he saw that nuclear fireball just spiraling up into the atmosphere, he quoted the Bhagavad Gita, where he said, "I have become death, the destroyer of worlds." And Oppenheimer was instantly sorry for the role that he had in the development of the weapon. But it was too late. The nuclear genie, so to speak, was out of the bottle. Now, the relationship between the United States and the Soviet Union, there are already warning signs as early as June 6, 1944, D-Day, that fragile alliance between not so much America and Great Britain, but definitely America, Britain, and the Soviet Union were already breaking down. On D plus 7, 7 days after D-Day, the Germans launched one of their secret weapons, the V-1 Doodlebug, or the V-1 Buzz Bomb. We kind of touched upon these in an earlier presentation, so I'm not going to delay too long here talking about this, just to say that this was one of a number of secret weapons that the Germans deployed toward the end of World War II. The other one that caught the attention of both the Americans and the Russians was the V-2 rocket. The V-2 rockets were being launched in March 1942 and early 1943. These were the ones that rained so much misery onto London and other points in England. One of the chief scientists behind the V-2 rocket program was Dr. Wernher von Braun. As American and Russian forces met at the Elbe at the end of World War II, particularly on April 25th, 1945, you see this joyous scene of American forces and Russian forces. They're shaking hands, they're greeting. They have been involved in the same project, defeating Nazi Germany. This is a very, very well-known picture showing American and Russian forces. This camaraderie, this kind of warm feeling for a moment after so much despair, after so much misery, after so much division, and just difficulty of just staying alive. This was a rare moment in World War II when the two opposing forces, although in alliance, could share a moment of gratitude and friendship. But as I point out, that moment of gratitude and friendship would not last. In fact, it was deteriorating rather quickly. You see here this Russian soldier hoisting the Soviet flag over Berlin. And based on this political cartoon, where you see the artist is showing your Grim Reaper carrying Hitler's body into hell. So Adolf Hitler joins the dustbin of history. But while that's going on, one sure sign of the division that would eventually come to supersede the alliance between the Soviet Union and the United States was Operation Paperclip. Please bear with me as I read. In the closing weeks of World War II, as Allied troops rumbled into German towns and the victors jockeyed to divide the spoils, one prize stood out: the people and machinery that had produced the V-2 rocket, one of the war's most exotic weapons. To the delight of U.S. intelligence, Wernher von Braun and most of his top associates on the V-2 development team chose to surrender to the Americans, shrewdly calculating where they might be allowed to continue their pioneering research after the war. One German rocket engineer sized up his options in April 1945 as follows: "We despise the French, we are mortally afraid of the Soviets, and we do not believe the British can afford us, so that leaves the Americans." In other words, These Russian scientists were weighing their options and choosing the best deal that would work for them. You see here in this picture, Werner von Braun and his brother, Magnus von Braun. I'll read again. The German rocket experts had been holed up for a week in an abandoned ski lodge on a Bavarian mountaintop when word came over the radio that Adolf Hitler was dead. One by one, the Nazi SS troops guarding the scientists disappeared. The Third Reich was just 6 days from collapse. The time had to come to cut a deal with the Americans. The German rocketry expertise that would be offered the Americans that day, combined with independent wartime advances by a group of California scientists, will lead to the first intercontinental ballistic missile, the first spy satellite, and the small step taken by astronaut Neil Armstrong on July 20th, 1969. Magnus von Braun, Werner's brother who spoke very good English, rode a bike down to the Austrian border when an American soldier pointed an M1 rifle at him. U.S. Army Private Fred Schneikert of Sheboygan, Wisconsin, eventually put down his weapon and let Magnus von Braun explain himself. American intel officers were summoned, and it was determined that von Braun's story had great value. Magnus von Braun told them about the V-2 rocket center at Peenemünde, the remote peninsula on Germany's Baltic coast. He told them that about Mittelwerk, a vast underground factory in central Germany where missiles were made by concentration camp slaves. 20 minutes later, Private Schneikert's lieutenant showed up with a carton of Camels. Cigarettes were like diamonds in those days. The deal was beginning to be made. Soon, Werner von Braun and others turned themselves in. About 1,000 other V-2 technicians were rounded up. In one of the most dramatic sequences of the war's final days, the Americans raced the Soviet army for the spoils of the V-2 program. So you see here, Dr. Werner von Braun with American personnel. And as this caption reads, Werner von Braun rocket science team surrenders to the U.S. 324th Regiment, 44th Infantry Division on May 2nd, 1945. Now keep in mind, the actual surrenders at Reims on May 8th to the Americans, the Canadians, and the British will take place 6 days later, and to the Russians in Berlin on May 9th. So surrender for the Nazis was coming pretty quickly. But while the alliance was shifting from Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Winston Churchill, to Joseph Stalin, FDR dies in the spring of 1945. And as per our constitutional system of succession, President Harry Truman, or his Vice President Harry Truman, moved into the president's chair. And now this is where the Cold War begins to take shape, at least in the early days with these three leaders. There was still Japan to deal with. And at the end of the war, the Japanese unleashed something called the kamikaze, the divine wind. This was a desperate attempt to inflict as much punishment upon the American Navy as possible. But although they were scary, although they were terrifying, although they were desperate, it was too late. And finally, the Americans dropped those two atomic bombs on August 6th and 9th on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, respectively. And Japan surrendered. Well, what about Operation Paperclip? What it was basically a bargain, or some people called it a handshake with the devil or a devil's bargain. On June 20th, 1945, Werner von Braun and 1,000 other Germany engineers and family members made the journey from East Germany into the US-held Western Zone just ahead of the advancing Red Army. Now keep in mind that Germany had already been decided upon with an agreement with Stalin, Truman, and Churchill that Germany would be divided into zones in the post-war period. So if the Germans surrender in May 1945, the next month in June, you got von Braun and these 1,000 other German engineers who are making their way fast as they can from the Soviets toward the Americans. The Soviets arrived and found the V-2 underground production center at Mittelwerk mostly abandoned and its top personnel gone along with missing key documents. Then 3 months later, Werner von Braun and six other German rocket experts arrived under guard at Newcastle Army Base in Wilmington, Delaware. They're transferred to Logan Field in Boston, then taken to Fort Strong, Long Island for processing. In the same month, a couple of days later, the first seven German technicians arrived in the U.S. at Newcastle Army Airfield. Then in October, the War Department announced that outstanding German scientists were being brought to the United States. As you can probably imagine, Albert Einstein, who had fled Nazi Germany in the 1930s, was objecting, had a lot of objection and heartache about this, but things were already on the move. And likewise, just as the Americans were getting their rocket scientists, the Russians were on the move getting theirs as well. You see here on the left, Soviet aerospace engineer Boris Chertok. In April 1945, just a few weeks before the war ended, Chertok arrived in Germany with orders to search for and evaluate Nazi technology, particularly the V-2 rocket. There was a scramble to get the German scientists. Chertok and his colleagues made risky trips to the American sector, offering the Germans hefty salaries, food rations, and the offer to stay in Germany. Staying in Germany was one of the few negotiating battles von Braun had lost with the Americans. The Americans assisted the von Braun and company come to the United States. A leading figure of the German rocket program that the Russians were able to recruit was a man named Helmut Gottrup. They promised him a lot, but eventually Gottrup and his family were forced to move to the Soviet Union. So you can see then, just by the activities of the Americans and the Russians over the V-2 rocket program, there's already a mad scramble to get a technological edge on each other as the dust was settling and the smoke was clearing as World War II ending. And then of course, there was the division of Germany into the American zone, the French zone, the British zone, and the Russian zone. The Soviet zone in green there, you'll notice that inside of the Soviet zone, deep inside of the Soviet zone, there was Berlin, which was also divided between the French, the Americans, the British, and the Soviets. Things went wrong quickly. On February 9th, 1946, at an event where Joseph Stalin, the leader of the Soviet Union, made a speech which became known as his Bolshoi speech. Bear with me as I share with you what he said. He basically blamed the West, saying Marxists have more than once stated that the capitalist economies, systems of the world economy, contains the elements of a general crisis and military conflicts that, in the view of that, the development of world capitalism in our times does not proceed smoothly and evenly, but through crises and catastrophic wars. The point is that the uneven development of capitalist countries usually leads, in the course of time, to a sharp disturbance in the equilibrium within the world system of capitalism, and that group of capitalist countries regards itself as being less securely provided with raw materials, and Marcus usually attempts to change the situation and to redistribute spheres of influence in his own favor by employing armed force. Look, Stalin said a lot of stuff in his speech, but basically what he was saying was that the capitalist nations were hostile, inherently hostile, they were inherently greedy, that when they couldn't get the things that would help them stay strong, they made war upon other people, and he also accused the West of bringing all of the misery that the Soviet Union had been through. On the one hand, technically, Stalin was not incorrect, because even under the Nazis, Germany was still a Western nation. However, Stalin had his own purposes and his own agenda for making this speech. He was seeking to make sure that the Soviet Union was positioned in the post-war world to dominate all of Europe and, in a more long-term sense, the world. Now, while Stalin was making this speech, the people in Washington, particularly the people back at the State Department in Washington, D.C., they had a diplomat in the Soviet Union who knew as much about the Russians as any American during this period. His name was George Frost Kennan. And George Frost Kennan became aware of Stalin's Bolshoi speech. And in his reaction to it, let me just share with you this little background on George Kennan. At the end of World War II, few in the West had experience with the Soviet Union, and even fewer understood what motivated the Soviets, except for George Frost Kennan. In 1946, while he was chargé d'affaires in Moscow, Kennan sent an 8,000-word telegram to the State Department, the now famous Long Telegram, it was called, on the aggressive nature of Stalin's foreign policy. He signed it Mr. X, and it was published in the 1947 issue of Foreign Affairs magazine, a very prestigious magazine then, and a very prestigious magazine even today. Kennan's conclusion was as follows. He said that the main element of any United States policy toward the Soviet Union, and stay with me here because this is very important. Kennan said that the main element of any United States policy toward the Soviet Union must be that of a long-term, patient, but firm and vigilant, and here's the word, containment of Russian expansive tendencies. Essentially, George Kennan was saying that for however long this conflict or this competition is going to last globally, America cannot afford to sleep. America cannot afford to get complacent. America cannot afford to take anything for granted. We must contain the Russians. When they move north, we move against them. Wherever they move on the planet, we have to be there to make sure to check their movement. So containment became basically the policy of the United States for confronting the Soviet Union around the world. In summary, USSR or Soviet leadership was unable, Kennan said, to see a long-term peaceful coexistence with the West. The Russians were inherently insecure. They were deeply suspicious of other nations. They were certain to attempt expanding their own sphere of influence. They were likely to aid people seeking to get from beneath the heel of colonial powers. In other words, American allies like the British and the French. The Soviets were impervious to logic, but they completely understood the logic of force. And again, the US and the West would have to resist Soviet attempts to expand when and wherever they tried to do so. In the meantime, while all that drama was going on in Europe, those Nazi scientists began to settle in to their new lives inside the United States. This picture right here shows the last of the 117 German rocket scientists from Operation Overcast or Paperclip arriving in El Paso, Texas. 12 were housed at White Sands while the rest resided at Fort Bliss. They were reunited, this is them being reunited for the first time since Peenemunde, and they were referred to as the team. The Cold War, just as things continued to just unravel or very quickly, a month after Stalin's Bolshoi speech, and then the response to it, George Frost Kennan's letter, long telegram to his bosses in Washington, advising that the Russians must be contained, Winston Churchill had been voted out of the office of prime minister by the British people. Despite all of his wonderful wartime and wonderful inspirational wartime leadership, he now found himself a private citizen. But on March 1946, he came to Fulton, Missouri and gave a speech that would go down as one of the greatest speeches in history. He said the following.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in Russia. I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow.
What Churchill was saying was that behind that Iron Curtain, from where it ended, from where it stopped in the West, and all points east, all of Eastern Europe and all of Russia, lay submitted or subjected to the iron, to the heel of the Soviet military boot on the neck of people, communist slavery behind the Iron Curtain. Now later on, when we get to Asia, there'll be something called the Bamboo Curtain. I remember when I was living in the Philippines as a kid, my father was stationed at Andrews Air Force Base. And oftentimes I would hear about the Iron Curtain in Europe, but they talked about the Bamboo Curtain in Asia. Similarly, when China was taking over a country or the fear of communism taking over countries in Asia and putting people in slavery under communist slavery behind the bamboo curtain.
There never was a war in history.
This image right here shows a chilling representation of that Iron Curtain that Churchill was talking about that extended from north to south across so many countries in Europe. Stalin responded to Churchill's Iron Curtain speech in the following manner. He said, it may be that some quarters are trying to push into oblivion these sacrifices of the Soviet people, which ensured the liberation of Europe, but the Soviet Union cannot forget them. What can be surprising in the fact that the Soviet Union, in a desire to ensure security for the future, tries to achieve that these countries should have governments whose relation to the Soviet Union are loyal? How can one qualify these peaceful aspirations of the Soviet Union as expansionist tendencies? The growth of the influence of communism cannot be considered accidental. It is a normal function. The influence of the communists grew because during the hard years of the mastery of fascism in Europe, communists showed themselves to be reliable, daring, and self-sacrificing fighters against fascist regimes for the liberty of peoples. Again, Stalin was not wrong. The Russian people had suffered tremendously. They had sacrificed greatly in the war against the Nazis and the fascists. But what Stalin failed to mention was that the same kind of liberty denied by the fascists, he was also denying to the people in the post-war world. It would have been one thing to have allies voluntarily, but they were not given that choice. So they traded one dictator for another one, and the Cold War expanded. By March 1947, communist insurgencies were starting to probe and feel and cause trouble in different parts of Europe. And particularly in 1947, in what was called the Greek crisis, Greece was in the process of possibly being overthrown by communist insurgents. The British, which had had a significant interest in Greece and a significant influence over that sphere of their empire, the British, after two world wars, especially the devastation of World War II, did not have the manpower, did not have the financial resources, did not have, frankly, the willpower to hold on to Greece as a sphere. So they had to make some real hard choices about which part of the empire they're going to preserve in the post-war period. And the Russians knew this. Now, with communist insurgents about to take over a European nation, the Truman administration on March 12, 1947, implemented, or should I say, announced something called, that became known as the Truman Doctrine. And this is where American foreign policy, that for all of our history, except for when the United States, for the most part, had been directly attacked, usually American foreign policy would only become involved in a conflict where it was clearly, you could draw mostly a clear line from the source of the threat to the harm that's being done to America. But on March 12, 1947, that changed when the president said, the United States will provide political, military, and economic assistance to all democratic nations under threat from external or internal authoritarian forces. It became known as the Truman Doctrine. And you know what? When you read about it casually, it sounds pretty good. America will provide political, military, and economic assistance to all democratic nations under threat from external or internal authoritarian forces. Until you start asking some questions. What comprised a democratic nation? What about those nations that call themselves democratic but had more of a socialist lean toward them? And how do you determine if a threat from external or internal forces, exactly what's the nature of the threat? How bad does it have to be? How much progress does it have to have made? This introduced, as the second paragraph indicates, a reorientation of US foreign policy away from its usual stance of withdrawal from regional conflicts not directly involving the United States. Friends, this is the first step toward getting to a situation in Vietnam where in the 1960s, people are sent to Vietnam and when they're asking, well, what are we fighting for? And the response often was, well, we're fighting for freedom. That's true, but it's still kind of a nebulous concept. What do you mean when you say that? It's not the same as saying, you know, we're going to defend the United States from Japanese attack. That people could understand, but fighting for freedom, fighting for liberty, fighting for democracy, all those things sound good. But when put to the test, when people ask you, what does that really mean? Foreign policy for America got a lot fuzzier and therefore a lot more difficult in the Cold War. And then there was the case of Berlin. Berlin, for most of the Cold War, would always be that linchpin, that fulcrum upon which the United States, it was its biggest concern. It frankly makes your head spin to consider how fast Germany, and especially West Germany, went from being a mortal enemy to a very necessary ally. The same thing with Japan. Japan went from being a mortal enemy to a necessary ally in a rapid amount of time because of the deteriorating situation between the United States and the Soviet Union. By the late 1940s, the competition and the arguing over Berlin, getting access to it, was reaching a crisis point. And in 1947, the Russians basically cut off access to the British, the Americans, and the French to West Berlin. The people in West Berlin did not have food. They were looking at a winter. They were looking at possible starvation. They were looking at freezing. They were looking at a number of things that was going to make life uniquely unpleasant. You can see here again from this map that Berlin was deep inside the Soviet zone. And if the Russians cut off land access to the city, how are the people in West Berlin supposed to survive? Well, they came up with a plan to fly in those supplies for as long as it was necessary. And that period of time, where the Americans and the British flew in the supplies to keep the people of West Berlin alive, was known as the Berlin Airlift, from April 1st, 1948 to May 12th, 1949. It was a stunning success. And the word was that the US Air Force could deliver anything. The British and the Americans, the British flying, as you see this plane in the foreground, C-47, they call that the Dakota, or C-54 Skymasters, round the clock fight, sometimes landing within mere moments of each other. It was a truly logistical miracle, and the Americans and the British both had earned the experience for making these kind of flights and these kind of deliveries during the World War II, or during the China-Burma-India theater, where they had kept the Chinese army supplied while flying supplies over the Himalaya Mountains. You can see some of the planes landing at Tempelhof Airfield. I used to work with a lady who was a child during the Berlin Airlift, and she said she could just remember how low these planes would come. And every now and then, a pilot would open up a window and throw candy out to the kids. She remembered those American and British pilots with such fondness. She said that they literally, quite literally, saved the lives of the people in West Berlin. So yes, as far as a humanitarian gesture, it was successful using the military to get around a crisis. But what this also did, since the Russians were prepared to see people starve, since the Russians were prepared to see people freezing to death, it removed all doubt that the Cold War alliance of World War II was over with. Now it was a full-on Cold War, and we move forward into the future. But you know, Europe was not the only place where things were going on with regard to competition between the West and communism. In China, in 1949, Mao Zedong on the left kicked Chiang Kai-shek on the right. Chiang Kai-shek had been an American ally during World War II. Chiang Kai-shek on the right was the leader of a group of people called the Kuomintang, or the Nationalist Chinese. Now, to be quite frank about it, the Nationalist Chinese under Chiang Kai-shek had problems. There were a lot of American policymakers who did not trust Chiang Kai-shek. They said he was corrupt, they said he was inept, and he wasn't too bright. Quite frankly, the brains in his outfit was Madame Chiang. She was the one who had convinced Claire Chennault to come to China to build an air force that eventually became known as the Flying Tigers. But in 1949, after having fought for years against the communists, Chiang Kai-shek was kicked off of mainland China. Mao Zedong and his communists took over mainland China, and the communists, at least the Communist Party, remains in charge of mainland China to this day. The People's Republic of China and Chiang Kai-shek being kicked off of the mainland onto what was called Formosa, today is called Taiwan. Also in 1949, the Soviet Union exploded their first atomic device. Now several things are happening. America's got to stand off in Europe against the Soviet Union. America in 1949 lost its nuclear monopoly. And look, let's be very clear about this. The Russians have their own technical capabilities. They're not dumb, but they were able to get this bomb and develop it very quickly because of an extensive spy network in the country. Their spies have been doing a good job getting them the secrets they needed. And now the American nuclear monopoly was over with. And what this meant then was that, among other things, in addition to the international competition, the United States could no longer go around muscling people on the basis of the fact that we had the bomb, and only we had the bomb. Now another country had the bomb. This introduced the necessity that if in fact you're not going to have an all-out nuclear exchange, and nobody wanted a nuclear exchange, what this meant then was that conventional wars took on a new kind of danger. You had to find a way of fighting them in a limited fashion. Hence the phrase limited warfare, which became the kind of war that was fought in Korea and the kind of war that was fought in Vietnam eventually and other places around the world. And speaking of Korea, the North Koreans crossed the Korean Peninsula on June 25th, 1950. And you can see this map. I'm not going to get too deep into this because we have another presenter who will be giving us some great information about the Korean conflict. But you can see from this map that the North Korean onslaught, when they first came across in that panel on the left, they pushed they pushed Allied forces all the way down to what's called the Pusan perimeter and almost into the Straits of Tsushima. But General MacArthur, who was the military governor of Japan, was ordered by President Truman to stage a counterattack, which he did at Incheon, and it nearly brought the war to a close, except for the fact that the Chinese came in on the side of the North Koreans, and the war lasted for another 3 years. But look, the Cold War still had a lot of things that were going to take place to make that competition between East and West even more acute. On October 4th, 1957, the world, and specifically the United States of America, was stunned when the Russians successfully launched into space the satellite called Sputnik. This caught American technicians, foreign policy experts, Department of Defense people, everybody off guard. You see, we had fallen into the trap of hubris. We knew that the Russians had a vast military capability, but it was just generally assumed that technologically the Russians were behind us. It doesn't seem like it would be possible today. It's very difficult to remember, but once upon a time, getting a rocket to launch into space or to lift off a launch pad and not blow up, that was a pretty big deal. It was very difficult. It's very difficult today. But in the 1950s, 1960s, you're still talking about rather new technology. That's one of the reasons why they wanted those German scientists. But when the Russians not only managed to put together a rocket that could take off from a launch pad, but it could break Earth's gravity and carry a cargo into space called a payload, the moment that people found out about Sputnik, they instantly started thinking that a nuclear-capable Soviet Union that could launch a satellite into space could just as easily take a nuclear warhead, put it on the tip of a missile, launch it into space, and America and its allies stood a good chance, so they thought, or at least were vulnerable, to the possibility of nuclear attack from space. The reaction inside the United States was swift. The political cartoons tell the story. Sergei Korolev, who is known as the father of the Soviet space program, said the Soviet Union has become the seacoast of the universe. As I mentioned, the headlines, the political cartoons tell the story of how worried people were about this development. U.S. views satellite as Russian victory. For the New York Times, Soviet fires Earth satellite into space. It is circling the globe at 18,000 miles per hour. Spear tracked over U.S. by radio signal. I used to, in my previous life, while working at aircraft braking systems in Akron, Ohio, I worked with a woman who was a child when Sputnik was shot into space. She grew up in West Virginia, and she said she can distinctly remember that at different times, you could stand on top of a mountain and see the satellite going across the night sky. She remembered it very vividly. And so did people of that generation. Sputnik, shadow spells crisis. This political cartoon, please bear with me as I read, says, political cartoonist Jim Berryman drew an observatory that resembled both the US Capitol, the Congress, and Sputnik, capturing America's anxious response to the successful launch of the Soviet satellite. The men watching sign emphasized the United States position, a witness just standing on the side being a spectator while the Soviet Union moved ahead at full speed ahead of America in its space program. And this one, our technical superiority will triumph in the, wait, what is that? And you can see the airplane says USA complacency. So what was America going to do now that the Russians had clearly shown that they were not as backwards as people thought? Well, it didn't take long. In September 1958, President Eisenhower signed into law legislation called the NDEA. It was the National Defense Education Act. This one act, this piece of legislation, would change the landscape of American higher education. This legislation, the National Defense Education Act, basically revamped the curriculum of liberal arts colleges, Research One universities across the country. Now there was more money being poured into math, science, engineering programs. The goal was to start with education at America's colleges and universities and catch up to the Russians. It was clear now that we had a technological deficit and the United States was determined to catch up. Now, on the one hand, it was a great result because we started pumping out engineers and mathematicians and physicists and chemists and people from in the physical and natural sciences from our universities. That was a great thing. And it created an environment at the time, a revamped education system in the United States with a heavy emphasis on technology, right at the same time, preparing the way for young students like Bill Gates and Stephen Jobs, who are brilliant and gifted all by themselves, to enter into that environment with the emphasis on technology and electronics. Because this is also the age of miniaturization, making things smaller, going from tube technology to transistors and miniaturizing things. So as students, Bill Gates and Stephen Jobs, they would be the beneficiaries of the changes that took place in classrooms at the university and college level. As you all know, Bill Gates and Stephen Jobs would eventually both leave college and go off and found, respectively, Microsoft and Apple Computer. But this whole atmosphere that allowed the computer revolution to take place was initiated by the NDEA in response to Sputnik being launched into space. The space race was yet another point of competition in the Cold War with the rise of communism and the competition with the West during the post-1945 period. And also, another byproduct of the NDEA was that while there was an emphasis, greater emphasis on math, science and engineering, things like history, political science, literature, art were de-emphasized. The country committed itself to a full-on steam ahead, catching up with the Russians and making sure that they would never be left behind again. Now, what eventually happens is that from the NDEA, Lyndon Johnson, who was the vice president, would spearhead an effort to found an organization called NASA. And a significant contributor to that organization, or on the way, somebody that helped him as an administrator, was just a wonderful woman named Eileen Galloway. Bear with me as I read. Eileen Galloway said the following: "While our first reaction to Sputnik was that we faced a military problem of technology and technological inferiority, the testimony from scientists and engineers convinced us that that outer space had been opened as a new environment and that it could be used worldwide for peaceful uses of benefit to all humankind for communications, navigation, meteorology, and other purposes." Think about the vision of Eileen Galloway. Everything she said about the possibilities of space is now a routine for us today. If you have a cell phone, you use the GPS on it. If you have, we get the weather and we expect to have weather reports round the clock, and we do. Communications is so much easier. Cell phone towers, you know, dish networks and so on. All these things about the possibilities of space, she was foreseeing that. But Eileen Galloway also went on to say, use of space was not confined to military activities. It was remarkable that this possibility became evident so soon after Sputnik, and its significance cannot be understated. The problem became one of maintaining peace rather than preparing the United States to meet the threat of using outer space for war. Fear of war changed to hope for peace. On July 29, 1958, the National Aeronautics and Space Act was signed into law or became effective. And here you see President Dwight Eisenhower meeting with NASA's first administrator and deputy administrator, Thomas Keith Glennon, right, and Hugh Dryden left. So we understand now that the standoff in Europe eventually became a standoff between NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, that was formed in 1949, a bunch of Western and Northwestern European powers in common, in what they call a common security or collective security, to stand as a bulwark against the Soviet presence from East Germany, Poland, Romania, Bulgaria. In 1955, the Russians formed their own collective security pact called the Warsaw Pact. So yeah, NATO and Warsaw Pact in Europe. But it was not, Europe was not the only continent that the Cold War was affecting. In the post-war world, if you look at this map of Africa in 1945, Africa is still dominated by colonial powers. All that dark reddish looking or dark brown area in West Africa, those were French colonies. The British were also very, very heavily present in Africa. Now, in the post-war world, what happened was that a number of African leaders approached the United States asking the Americans to support them in their attempt to seek independence. African colonial subjects, African colonial soldiers, had been brought from the continent to Europe in World War I to fight against on the battlefields of Europe, and they have been asked to do it again in World War II. After two world wars, African colonial soldiers and African leaders were very much aware of the fact that the Europeans, the French, and the British did not have the military power, did not have the economic depth and breadth to hold onto their colonies because, among other things, while a colony may be very, very prestigious, it's expensive to run. And these African leaders were shrewd enough, brilliant enough to know that the French and the British had seen their better days as colonizers. So on a number of occasions, they approached the United States asking for America's assistance to help them become independent. The United States needed the cooperation of the French and the British in Europe as part of that collective security to stand toe-to-toe with the Russians. So the decision was made that Europe would be the priority to check, or to borrow George Kennan's phrase, to contain the Russians. And because the decision was made to prioritize Europe over African independence, what eventually happened was that the United States, ironically enough, found itself siding with the colonizers. African independence movements did not take to this kindly. And as the Cold War turned into the 1950s, and especially into the 1960s, in the early 1960s, and especially in West Africa, you can see from this map that Guinea will get independence in 1958, Ivory Coast or Cote d'Ivoire in 1960, Burkina Faso in 1960, Dahomey or Benin in 1960, Nigeria in 1960. In the early 1960s, it seemed like every time you turn around, another African nation was gaining independence from one of the former colonizers. Now, the legacy of that, what that meant then, was that some African leaders who would have come to the United States did not. What they did instead was they went to the Soviet Union, or to one of the nations in the Soviet bloc. Czechoslovakia is the one that comes to mind. If you look down here at Zambia or Rhodesia, which is today called Zimbabwe, Robert Mugabe, the leader who passed away just a few years ago, a little while ago, from Zimbabwe, during one of the wars to get rid of the white minority government, Robert Mugabe called himself a Marxist-Leninist. But Robert Mugabe was actually a nationalist. But he would say whatever he needed to say, and he did say whatever he needed to say to get the weapons that he needed to fight against the army of Ian Smith and the white minority government in Rhodesia until they finally drove them out and renamed the country Zimbabwe. Another part of what happened during the Cold War was that because the United States prioritized Europe over Africa, when these nations became independent, they formed a voting bloc inside the United Nations. So time after time after time again, when Americans sought to do something internationally, it was not at all unusual that nations that found themselves either isolated would form this voting bloc. The one that comes to mind is the Non-Aligned States, the organization called the Non-Aligned States, and they formed a voting bloc that sometimes was enough to thwart the United States' efforts to get international cooperation to work against the Russians, contain the Russians, or to do something else trying to keep world peace. It became a very, very tricky situation in Africa, and eventually, the Cold War was spread to Central America and South America. But you can see that the Cold War consumed Asia. It consumed Europe. It definitely had a foothold in Africa. I didn't even talk about the Middle East, the Suez Crisis of the 1950s. It will be there. The Middle Eastern Crisis, the Six-Day War, the Three-Day War, the Six-Day War in the Middle East, the fact that Syria will be aligned with the Russians for a while, the Syrian leader, Bashar Hafez al-Assad, is the father of the current leader of Syria, Bashar al-Assad. And the playbook of the father is being used by the son right now in putting down the attempts to become independent or become free of the Syrian people. So the seeds sown from 1945 until 1953 from 1945 to 1960, in that 15 years of the Cold, that 15 years of the World War II, not only did it introduce us to the Cold War, not only did it introduce us to the possibility that now America, Soviet Union, and eventually other powers possess the power to possess world-ending weapons, it produced a constant dynamic of competition and hot wars fought during a Cold War that could not be fought to the conclusion of unconditional surrender, which is what American leaders have been used to since the time that Ulysses S. Grant had demanded unconditional surrender from General Simon Bolivar Buckner at Fort Henry and Fort Donelson in early 1862. Those days were gone. It will be the reason why the United States will have to accept a ceasefire in 1953 in Korea, and why Vietnam will go so horribly, horribly wrong. I'll tell you this, and then I'll go ahead and wind up so we can go ahead and have some discussion and Q&A. For the last few years, my colleague, Dr. Scott Vanderstoop, and I have been taking students to Vietnam because we, of course, want them to know, it's to expose them to another culture, but really to teach them about the Vietnam War, to help them understand why America got involved in Vietnam, and why 58,000 young people who just did their duty. Most of them didn't want to go, but the majority of them did go. They didn't like it. They didn't want to be there. They missed home. They missed their loved ones. They missed their sweethearts. But they went and they did their duty anyway. And they did not understand, like I said earlier, they were told you're going to fight for freedom. Again, what does that mean? They can understand it in a very, very vague kind of sense. But what's the real immediate existential threat to me, my home in Peoria or in Schenectady, or in Chicago, or in Oakland? How is that affecting that community? It's very difficult to draw those one-to-one connections, but they went anyway. But the last time that I was in Vietnam, the guy who pretty much is our point of contact over there, he brought to me some documents from an organization that was established in 1946 called the Vietnam America Friends Association. And in 1946, while the war was still barely over with, the Vietnamese, particularly Ho Chi Minh and Vietnamese, had been working with American agents from the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services, the forerunner of the CIA, fighting against the Japanese in Vietnam. And they'd been very good. Toward the end of the war, one of these American operatives asked Ho Chi Minh if he was a communist. And Ho Chi Minh said, "Yes, I am." He was more a nationalist than he was a communist, but Ho Chi Minh said, "Yes, I am, but that shouldn't make a difference. We can still be friends, can't we?" The answer was, actually, no, we can't. The Vietnam America Friends Association was an organization established by the Vietnamese after World War II that reached out to the United States, that reached out to the State Department, that wanted to have good relations and trade agreements and cultural exchange programs between the United States. But the fast descending fears and suspicions and hostilities about communism as World War II ended and the dust settled and the smoke cleared, took that initiative and moved it right out the way. And by the time you got to 1954, Dinh Binh Phu, when the Viet Minh will defeat the French and get them out of Vietnam, when the French leave Vietnam at that fantastic, spectacular victory by the Viet Minh, the Viet Minh at Dinh Binh Phu, that is the turning point where America, barely out of Korea, will make the decision to get involved more deeply in the crisis and the conflict that became known as the Vietnam War. The Cold War took on yet another new shape, and the decision to get involved in Vietnam was in part a response to a policy known as the domino theory, where people believed that if Korea fell, if Vietnam fell, if Cambodia fell, if Laos fell, in other words, if one nation fell, all the rest would fall in succession, like dominoes. This was a sincerely held belief by policymakers in the early days of the Cold War. And I like to tell my students, you have to understand the context of what they've been through. They had lived through World War I. They had lived through World War II. They had seen the appeasement of Neville Chamberlain and Edouard Daladier of France. They knew that if you try to negotiate and appease bullies internationally, that they sooner or later, they'll attack you anyway. And if you wait to fight them later than sooner, you'll end up losing more people. So that generation of World War II, that generation that we call the greatest generation, they were fully prepared to not make that mistake this time when the new bully was communist China and communist Russia. They were going to stand their ground, draw lines in the sand, and fight where they had to, when they had to, limited or otherwise, to make sure that the mistakes of World War II were not repeated. It was the Cold War, one of the most dangerous periods of human history. I'll be more than happy to take your questions now. You're muted, Peg.
I have to joke. I'm telling everyone, if anyone would like to unmute themselves and ask a question, it's great, but I was still muted. So anyone that would like to ask a question, please ask. I saw, you know, in going through this period of time, I find it utterly amazing on so many things that one of the reasons that we've decided to do our spring lecture series this year is on the era of the post-Vietnam until 1990, because so many interesting things in our military have been involved in during that period of time is just, we don't know anything about it because they weren't the major conflicts. They weren't the ones that made the headlines every morning. Right. And at the end of Vietnam, people were not very interested in knowing what the military was doing. They wanted nothing to do with the military. But because of the policies that we had set forth at the end of World War II, we couldn't just back away the way we did in World War I or the isolationism that we wanted to do in World War II. We had to be the world's policemen, basically. And we were so involved in NATO and everything else. So our spring lecture series will be on the period of post-Vietnam until 1990.
But you know what, Peg, there's another issue there, and that if you think about the American presidents who served as chief executive after the Second World War, Harry Truman had been an artillery officer in World War I, all right?
Yes.
John F. Kennedy served in the U.S. Navy and had been injured at sea. Richard Nixon has served in the Navy. Lyndon Johnson.
And Eisenhower may have had something to do with it.
Eisenhower was the chief planner and the politician general who was the supreme commander of the supreme headquarters Allied European forces that planned D-Day. And then you got Lyndon Johnson, like I said, was in the Navy. Nixon was in the Navy. So most of those leaders in the post-war world, they all had the common denominator experience of time in the military, right? And
Jimmy Carter was our only president to be a full-time submariner.
That's right. Jimmy Carter was a full-time submariner, Naval Academy graduate, brilliant, intellectual and whatnot. But, and that's why I've often wondered, should we add military service as a qualification to be president? Because like Douglas MacArthur said, when people in his speech before Congress, when he slowed down, he said, "For this, people have called me a warmonger." And you can just feel the rage building in him when he said, "I know war as few men now living know it. And nothing to me is more revolting." And MacArthur was right. He had dedicated his entire adult life to the profession of arms. And even though he had been a soldier all his life, he had a front row seat to misery. There was no one more qualified than Patton, MacArthur, Eisenhower, General Omar Nelson Bradley to explain to people why war is the last thing you should want to do. Not these, yes. not these little, these martinets who go around, wanting to you know, goose-stepping, thinking that war is some great and glorious adventure. People have been to war. They don't think it's great and glorious. In other words, they'll tell you that you should do everything to avoid it. On the other hand, they'll also tell you that when there's no other option but to fight, you go fight, and you do what Colin Powell did when it came to the first Gulf War.